1 John 4:7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. I know so many Christians that love to take a little sound bite here, a little sound bite there, a little verse here, a little half verse there, and build a whole theology around it. And there are so many examples just within this passage alone, 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 21, where Christians take a little bit here and a little bit there, and they build a whole theology around it. There's a lot of talk about love, especially in today's Western culture. Love is love, they say. Love wins, they say. But what is love according to the scriptures? According to God's definition of love, what is love? See, to one person, love would be cutting your neighbor's grass. To another person, love would be sleeping with your neighbor's wife. But love according to the scriptures has nothing to do with sex. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4. Love suffers long. In other words, love is patient. That's what it means. And is kind. As I'm reading this, think about what today's culture of love is all about. It's certainly not patient, and in many ways, it's not kind. Love does not envy, it says. Love does not parade itself. True love, according to the scriptures, according to the holy scriptures, does not parade itself, is not puffed up. In other words, it has nothing to do with pride. It is not proud. It is not arrogant. Does not behave rudely, does not seek its own. Love, according to today's culture, does all of that. It seeks its own. It's all about pleasing yourself. It's all about doing what you want to do. Is not provoked. Again, in today's culture, the so-called love that they push is very easily provoked, very easily triggered. Thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity. This word iniquity here, meaning against the law of God. True love, according to the scriptures, does not celebrate anything that's against the law of God, but rejoices in the truth. Today, the so-called love culture cancels the truth, bears all things. In other words, it puts up with everything, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. That's true love. Having said that, let's get back to 1 John chapter 4. Verse 8, he who doesn't love doesn't know God, for God is love. A lot of people who don't really know what love is, as defined by the Holy Scriptures, love to quote this. They're like, well, I'm all about love, and God is love, therefore I'm with God. Other people are like, well, God is love, therefore how can God do anything that I don't like? Don't forget, the scriptures also say that God is judge. Again, don't take this little soundbite out of context of the rest of the scripture. It also says that God is judge. It also says that God is a consuming fire. Look at Nadab and Abihu, for example. They were consumed by the fire of God because they sinned. They were left as just a couple of piles of ashes. Yes, God is love, but God is also judge, and God is also a consuming fire. Therefore, we need to fear God, as the scriptures teach us from Genesis to Revelation. Verse 9, by this God's love was revealed in us, that God sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as the atoning sacrifice for our sins. It's very important to understand that this term atoning sacrifice in the original manuscripts comes from one word in the Greek that means simply appeasing. It really doesn't say anything about sacrifice. So the translators here added words that it really doesn't say in the original manuscripts. What it literally says is that God sent his Son as an appeasing for our sins. Verse 11, beloved, if God loved us in this way, we ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God remains in us and his love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we remain in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. I've heard people say, well, the Spirit of God is in everybody. If that's the truth, why does it say in the scriptures time and time again that the Spirit departed from people? And why does it say in the scriptures that the Spirit filled certain people at certain times if the Spirit was there already? And I've had someone tell me that Jesus is in everybody's heart. If that's the truth, why did Jesus say in the book of Revelation, I stand at the door and knock? I'm on the outside. I want you to let me in. Verse 14, we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God remains in him and he in God. Again, don't take this verse and isolate this verse from the rest of Scripture. Say, well, I confess that Jesus is the Son of God, therefore God must be in me. Even the demons confessed that he was the Son of God. And don't take this out of context as to what John said earlier on in this same chapter as to how to test the spirits. Verse 16, we know and have believed the love which God has for us. God is love, and he who remains in love remains in God, and God remains in him. In this, love has been made perfect among us, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, even so are we in this world. Verse 18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has punishment. He who fears is not made perfect in love. In context here, this is talking about fearing the day of judgment, because for one reason or another, maybe you haven't repented of your sins yet. This is not talking about fearing God. The scriptures teach us all the way through to fear God, because when we fear God, we hate evil. And when we hate evil, we shy away from sin. And when we repent of our sins, we don't have to worry about judgment. Verse 19, we love him because he first loved us. Reminds me of what Jesus said to his disciples. You didn't choose me, I chose you. Verse 20, if a man says, I love God, and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who doesn't love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? In other words, it's harder to love someone that you don't see. So how can you say, I love that person that I don't see, but yet the person that you see, you don't love? Verse 21, this commandment we have from him, that he who loves God should also love his brother. I have faithfully attended different churches throughout my life. And I find one thing very interesting. When I leave a certain church, nobody asks me why. The pastor doesn't call me up and say, oh, where are you? I don't know what happened. And out of all the churches I've been to that I faithfully attended for a period of time, and then I left that church, out of hundreds of people, only one person actually asked me, oh, why did you leave that church? If you truly love somebody and they disappear from your social group, wouldn't you love them enough to hunt them down and fight? What's going on? What happened to you? Are you okay? As a pastor, the word pastor actually means shepherd. If one of the sheep wanders away, wouldn't you love that sheep enough to go find that sheep? But that has never happened to me. And let me take this a little bit deeper. I have found that people who say that God loves and accepts everybody are the first ones to block me, unfriend me, ignore me, and reject me. People who say, oh, you're supposed to show the love of Jesus. When I challenge their theology, they're the first ones to reject me. They're the first ones to kick me out. I've had that happen. In fact, I went to a church once and I sat down with the pastor in a private setting. And he said, well, you know, the way people preach the gospel nowadays, they don't show the unconditional love and acceptance of God. If you're just out there telling people to repent, that's really not showing the unconditional love and acceptance of God. And I told him, well, you know what? You may be against that style of preaching, but what you're doing is really not effective either. And he told me, get out of my church. I don't want to ever see you again. I walked out and I said, thank you for showing me the unconditional love and the unconditional acceptance of God. Hypocrite.